The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Well, good morning or good afternoon, depending on what part of the country you're in. Welcome to the IT Synergy Hacking the Human monthly webinar series. Thanks very much for joining us. Today, we are going to be talking about the latest phishing techniques. So we've got a lot of examples and things to share with you today. So given that, let's jump right in and get started. So why are we here? A couple of statistics for you. Back in 2014, IBM did a study that found that 95% of all security incidents involved human error. That was followed up with a couple of studies in 2015, the first one by CompTIA, that found that 52% of human error was the root cause, or I'm sorry, 52% of security breaches, the root cause was human error. And Experian also did a study that year that found that employees and negligence were the leading cause of security incidents, but remained the least reported issue. And so our goal in the next 14 minutes is to give you some quick action items to help you be security smart and not be one of those statistics up above there. And I would encourage you to join us on the second Thursday of every month. We do these webinars at 11:30 a.m. Arizona time, and we have a new topic every month. So let's jump in. Today's topic is the latest phishing techniques. So what is the problem? Why are we talking about this? Well, I thought we'd start out with just a definition of phishing. And so there's a lot of text there, but essentially what it is phishing is an attempt to fool you into taking some sort of action on your computer under false pretenses, is basically the way to think of phishing. And the most common method, when we think of phishing, we often think of email. There are also other forms of phishing via text message, via telephone. Again, all designed under false pretenses to get you to take some type of action, click a link, open a file, etc. Some statistics regarding phishing, this one blew me away. There are nearly 1.5 million new phishing sites created every month. And so when we talk about phishing sites, it's when you click on that link, the malware site or the bad guy site that it takes you to is a phishing site. 1.5 million of those created every month. A third of customers said that they would stop dealing with a business following a cybersecurity breach, even if they don't suffer a material loss. And so this is really significant when we think about the danger of phishing. If anyone on the webinar today can imagine a third of your customers just walking out the door tomorrow, even if they didn't suffer a loss, there's pretty significant risk involved in cybersecurity. And so something that we definitely want to be aware of. And then this one is also very surprising. Verizon does a big data breach report every year. And in their most recent report, they found that 30% of phishing messages get opened by the target recipient, and 12% of those users click on the attachment or the link. So a very surprising statistic that 30% of the messages, so one third of the messages are successful in getting through and getting opened. And out of those one third, 12% of those folks click on the link. And so from a numbers perspective, you can tell this is pretty lucrative for the bad guy. So you say, okay, I get it. I'm in. How can I tell if it's a phishing message or not? So we've got a bunch of tips for you here, along with samples for each one. So probably the most important thing or technique that you can use to determine if an email message is phishing or not is by hovering over the links in the email. So here's our first example of a phishing message. You can see this message purports to send me a scanned receipt. It says here, John asked me to scan and forward you a copy of your receipt. Here's a link to the scanned receipt, and you can see it is a Dropbox link. And so you think to yourself, okay. And you know, John is one of the most common names that we see used in these phishing emails, just because that's a very common name. And so you might be very likely to click on, figuring that it's safe to click on a shared file from Dropbox, you might be willing to click on that link and see what happens. But what you'll find if you hover your mouse over that link and click on it, you'll see now without clicking on it, by just hovering the mouse, you'll see that it says rentpartner.com, .pl, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So even though the text of the link says dropbox.com, if we just hover our mouse over it before we click on it, it will pop up and tell us where that link actually goes. And you can see it does not go to dropbox.com. And so that's a surefire way to know that this is potentially a phishing issue. Next question is, how's your English? One of the most popular dead giveaways for determining if a message is a phishing message or not is poor English. If the grammar isn't correct, if the punctuation isn't correct, all those sorts of things, that is a dead giveaway that it's probably a phishing message. So all kinds of signs here. I pointed out a couple of them here. The 16th of January period, 2018 comma. That's both represents improper use of punctuation. And then if you read the next sentence even beyond that, which are waiting approval to be delivered. Please not that this may cause mailbox malfunctions, et cetera, et cetera. So some spelling errors, some grammar errors, all kinds of issues here. So anytime you see any of those types of things, your radar should definitely go up that this is very likely a phishing message. Is it too good to be true? So we're all seeing a lot of these days. We're seeing gift cards from Home Depot, gift cards from Amazon. You've won a free pizza from Pizza Hut, all these types of things. And you can see here that, you know, it's using the Home Depot colors. It has the Home Depot logos, et cetera, et cetera. Bottom line, if it sounds too good to be true, it probably is too good to be true. This is a clear example of a phishing message, regardless of how legitimate it looks. There's nobody that is just going to randomly send you an email out of the blue and offer you money or even in the form of a gift certificate. Who is the email from? So here's a message that purports to be from the FBI, and it talks about they've completed an investigation on the money transfer issue we recently reported, and it's been paid out, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so this might be something that, especially if you had recently suffered some type of a financial issue, you might pay attention to. But what you can see if you look up in the very top of this is that this is from bulletmail.org. So the address that the message is being sent from is clearly not related to the FBI. And so always check to see the address that the message is coming from. And if it's coming from an address that doesn't seem legitimate, it is likely a phishing message. Don't let logos fool you. Here's an example of a phishing message. It's got the Microsoft logo there. It's got the Office 365 logo there. It says, I've received a PDF document. Rachel just shared a file with me. I can click there to view the file. So just because it's got all the right logos, the Microsoft logo, the Office 365 logo, all those sorts of things, does not mean that it's legitimate. So again, if we hover our mouse over the click here to view now, and again, we don't want to click, we're just hovering the mouse. You can see that this actually goes to linkanovak.com/fold/off, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So again, very clear sign that this is a phishing message. And I'm using that same test that we talked about at the beginning. I'm just hovering my mouse over the link without clicking. And I can see clearly this does not go to anything related to Microsoft Office. Don't trust the domain name that the message comes from. So we talked earlier about looking at the address that a message comes from is one of the ways to detect a phishing message. Well, in this case, this is a message that says, John sent a document to me. John is obviously sending me a lot of messages. And this, again, has all the things that we've talked about earlier. It's got the Dropbox logo. This is exactly what an email would look like when a file is shared with me via Dropbox. And there's a link here where I can view document now. And if you even look at the upper part of the message where the return address is, it claims to come from dbox.net. You've got to be very careful about this. So you might look at that and think that dbox.net is actually a valid server that Dropbox might be sending messages from. However, it is absolutely not. Dbox.net is not a Dropbox domain name. And so the bad guys are very clever about using these kinds of tricks with fake domain names, in this case, dbox.net. Another popular one that they do is they'll substitute just one character in the domain name so that it looks close, but it's not quite. So for example, instead of paypal.com, it might come from paypa1.com. So as you can imagine, an L and a 1 look very similar on a computer. And so if you look at that address, if you just glance at it quickly, you might think it came from paypal.com, but it in fact did not. So pay very, very close attention to the domain names and don't trust that just because it looks similar or it's close or it seems related, that it is actually a valid email and a valid domain name. The next one is just because the content of the email is highly technical and sounds complex does not mean that it's valid. So here's an example of a message I got. It claims to come from the administrator. And it uses all kinds of technical terms. It talks about who is verification, which is a very technical term, action required. In the middle, in bold, it talks about they're required to deactivate domain names if the registrant information is not verified. It talks about in the first paragraph, the icons, who is, accuracy specification, all these types of things that make it sound and look very official. And you can even see at the very, very bottom of the message, it claims to come from Google Inc. So the bad guys are throwing everything that they can think of, including the kitchen sink, at you to try to make you think that this is, in fact, a legitimate message. However, just because it involves a highly technical topic and seems technical and possibly something that isn't totally clear to the average user does not mean that it's legitimate. So this, in fact, is another bad email. If we hovered over any of the links in this email, we would see that they go to very, very different addresses than where they purport to go to. And so just because of it looks official doesn't mean that it is official. When you get a message, one of the things that you want to do is think, don't just react. So here's an example of a message that purports to be an unauthorized sign-in on your Apple account. Now, some interesting things about this message. First of all, it looks very much like a message from Apple might look. I mean, their design style is a very clean design style. It utilizes a lot of white. You can see here we have the Apple logo up in the upper right corner. And so this follows kind of the design guidelines that an email from Apple might look like. Also, the interesting thing about this is it says your Apple ID was just used to sign in on a MacBook Pro 15-inch. The interesting thing about that is obviously, you know, a large percentage of people who receive this email don't have a MacBook Pro 15-inch, and so they're going to immediately dismiss this. However, there is some percentage of people who receive this email that do in fact have a MacBook Pro 15-inch. And if you do, by the time you read that first line, you're already freaking out that possibly your account has been hacked because of this unauthorized sign-in. So you might not even look at the rest of this message or even think about, you know, gee, is this a legitimate message or not? Because you're just going to have an emotional reaction out of fear that your account has been hacked. Obviously, the link works the same way here. It claims to go to apple.com. If we hover our mouse over that, it clearly does not. And so you want to make sure that you're not having an emotional reaction to a potential phishing email. But every email needs to be kind of evaluated in the same logical fashion. The next step is that the government, and when I say the government, I'm using that term generically. So that could be your local government, your state government, the federal government, agencies of the federal government, all those types of things. They are rarely going to send you a legitimate email. And so anytime you see emails from, you know, the FBI or the IRS or any of those types of things, none of those agencies will generally communicate with you via email. They're generally going to communicate via other methods. And so the government rarely mails. Now, what I have here is an example, and I thought this was a particularly good phishing technique, is it claims to come from the police department. And it talks about the parking ticket. There's my ticket ID number. It says I got a parking ticket. It cites what appears to be some kind of a statute number there is what they're going for, the 30-938, parking of motor vehicles, court appearance is required. But fortunately, this message tells me I can click on this link and pay my fine. And if you do click on that link and you do pay that fine, congratulations to you. You have just funded the cybercrime underground by doing so. And so just keep in mind that, and again, we can look at some other signs here that we've talked about earlier in the webinar. The fact that it comes from, I'm not even going to try to pronounce that domain name, zistolika.ru, which is a Russian domain name. So obviously, I haven't gotten a parking ticket in Russia, etc. But just the fact that it comes from a government agency, a lot of times will lend legitimacy to it. And so that's also something to be on the lookout for. So with that, I will go ahead and wrap up. I hope today's information was helpful to you. Our next webinar is coming up March 8. That's again the second Thursday of March. We do this the second Thursday of every month, 11:30 a.m. Arizona time. You can register for that webinar right now at itsynergy.com/webinar. We're going to talk next month about file sharing services. So Google, Dropbox, OneDrive, all of the file sharing services. And we're going to talk about the good, the bad, and the ugly. So we're going to go through the file sharing services. We're going to kind of talk about why you might use one of those services. But most importantly, we're going to talk about if you do use one or more of those services, how you can do so in a secure fashion. Like I said, our webinars are the second Thursday of every month at 11:30 a.m. You can also see all of our past webinars, and we've been doing this for several years now, on our YouTube channel. If you go to itsynergy.com/YouTube, you will find that information there. And I would also encourage you to subscribe to our YouTube channel so that as we post new content to that channel, you'll get a notification letting you know that we've got new webinars out there. So thank you very much for joining us today. There I am. There is my contact information. If you have any questions, I would be happy to answer them. And I hope you have a great day.